Hey, good morning, church family. Welcome to FCC Online. We're so excited about another opportunity for us to gather and again be able to praise God for what it is He's doing as we look at His famous last words together. Hey, this year's Easter offering is specially designated toward a group that we want to make you more aware of, and that is CRAM, Christians Reaching Asian Ministries. And this is brand new to our church, but have been around for a long time. The money we're specifically giving this year for Easter is going to be directed at one particular portion of what CRAM supports, and that is the Sharon House. And the Sharon House is for individual teenage girls who've been brought out of sex trafficking, again, teaching them, educating them, and putting them on a platform to be able to be successful without the place they've been. And I'm excited about being able to offer this opportunity, but we want to let you see a little bit more about CRAM by watching this video and see more about what they're about.
Pinakamababa, 200, tapos 300, ganun. My name is Mylin Bistal. Nung ano pa, 1998, ganun lang tatahi. Yung sa ano naman, yung kita ko naman, pinagsikapan ko rin na ano, kakain kami ng maayos. Okay lang, pero yung talagang wala kaming natabi, ganito, ganyan. Kasi kulang pa sa ano yung pag-aaral ko ng mga anak ko, lalo pa yung mga high school ko, ano na, grade 11. Tapos ito, nalaglag sa dagat. Ano pa, 7 years? Ano na rin yan, wala nang buhay. Naligtas naman po. Kaya sabi ko, wala talagang imposible pag manalig lang. Malaki po kasi yung anak ko, tapang nag-aayon sa pag-aaral, tapos tuloy-tuloy na yung ano na, hindi na siya nag-absent. Pero pinagsikapan ko rin na ano yung hindi sila mag-absent kasi ayaw kong ganun nga mag-absent-absent. Lalo ngayon nga, tatlo high school ko. Talagang na-sponsor na siya, tuloy-tuloy na yung pag-Bible ko, nag-aati na rin ako ng simba. Parang ayaw ko nang magano, excited na nga ako pag ano, Sabado. Mas malaki rin ay katulong kasi marami kaming natutunan sa ano, pagsimba. Parang may dumadating sa amin ng blessings, ganun. Hindi namin inaasahan na may darating pala. Nakakaraos din sa awa ng Diyos. Kahit mahirap, tiis, jaga.
Hey, I am so excited about the body of Christ being able to gather on Easter Sunday like I am every Sunday. But I want you to know, those of you who are watching at home, you'll still be able to view us at 10 a.m. on Easter Sunday, April the 4th. But also, we are now adding 3 service times to our regular schedule of what we do on Sundays for that particular Sunday. Our service times are going to be at 8, 9:30, and 11. And we'd love for you just to come in. We're going to gather for worship and go. We're not going to have any small groups meeting during that time. And again, just the opportunities for the body of Christ to be able to be energized by the resurrected Savior. Looking forward to our time together. On Friday, April the 2nd, we're looking forward to a Good Friday gathering for our church body, and we'd love for you to come and join us at 7 p.m. for a night of worship that we're going to have, and it's going to be specifically called Bloom. We're calling it Bloom because we're looking at the idea that we've all been cooped up in our places over the last year, and who doesn't need something to know that something can blossom out of this, that goodness can come out of what it is that Christ Jesus has come for. And so we want to invite you to come April the 2nd, 7 p.m. for a night of worship called Bloom. Love to have you here. On April 24th, we're going to join in a community event that's been around for some time now called Rascals. It's an opportunity for us to help reach out to people who are senior citizens within the city of Fairfield. And on Saturday, April 24th, you can sign up for a time whenever you can be part of a team that's going to help to rake leaves, to clean gutters, to wash windows, to kind of do a spring cleaning kind of an event for each of those families that we come in contact with. There'll be opportunities for you to sign up online, or you could do that physically within the church building, an opportunity to be on a team on that Saturday. It goes from 8:30 until 1 on that Saturday. Again, a quick cleanup, teams of 10, t-shirts involved. If you sign up before Easter, you'll be able to get a shirt and be guaranteed that. Beyond that, it's really just an opportunity for us to serve in the body of Christ. Find out more and join us if you can. You know, so many times in our life, we'll say something is finished and we think it's over. It's done. And in Jesus, here we are in the sixth week of talking about the things that Jesus has said while he's on the cross, famous last words. And today's last word is finished. And I think when we hear Jesus say, "It is finished," we somehow think things are done. In fact, it's actually the opposite. Jesus is clarifying things are just beginning. I've completed what I've come to do. And I don't know about you, but man, in the middle of everything we've got going on, it's awesome to know that Christ Jesus still has come to complete the work that he came to finish. We're going to be talking about that and so much more this morning as we open up God's Word. Looking forward to our time of worship, but let's pray about what we might receive from that as we get started. And now, Lord God, we come thanking you again for the body of Christ, both those that can physically gather within our facility and those who are watching now at home. And we're praying, God, that you would be with each one of us as we open up your word. And again, we listen from these words that Jesus has spoken directly from the cross, a verification of victory, not one of defeat, when he says it is finished. And I'm praying, God, that you would challenge us in that victory and that we would live out that purpose in our life as well, that we would finish the work that you've given us to do. Be with us in all that we do and say, through our giving, through our communion, through our times of being able to share in God's word, our singing. We're praying, God, that everything that we do and say would reflect more and more our love for you. Thank you again for it now. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's get going.
Go on and tell it to the masses. can wash away my sin. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh,
boys and girls. I hope that you're enjoying some spring weather out there. And you know, with springtime comes one of the best holidays ever, especially for Christians, because Easter is the holiday that we celebrate the most, the day that Jesus rose from the dead. But you know, there were some pretty horrible moments leading up to that beautiful sunrise Easter that we're going to talk about in a couple of weeks. And I want to talk just a little bit about Jesus being on the cross. And I want to try to help you understand how important that was to us with a little object lesson that I have here. I'm going to use this nickel. And this nickel is going to represent us. It's going to represent our life here on earth. Now, the Bible plainly tells us that all of us have something that enters into our life. And that something that enters into our life is sin. And I'm going to use this brown liquid, it's just tea, here to represent sin, because sin is all around us. And unfortunately, a lot of times we let that sin take over our lives. We let it get into our hearts, and it's not a good place to be. Well, luckily for us, Jesus came to the world, right? He was born in a manger, and he came. And the Bible tells us that Jesus was the light of the world, right? And that's what this candle represents. This candle represents how Jesus came to the earth, and he had a ministry here where he spread the good news of Jesus, the good news to everybody that he came in contact with. Even around sinners, he didn't care. He wanted them to be saved too. Well, later on in his ministry, a bunch of people decided, Jesus, we don't like you telling all these things to these people. And you remember the story. They arrested Jesus. They accused him, and they nailed him to a cross. And Jesus hung on that cross for quite a while, all day long. And he suffered, and it was getting really close to the end. And at the very end of his time on that cross, he said three very familiar words. He said, "It is finished." Well, you know, boys and girls, those three words mean a whole lot more than "I'm going to die right now." When Jesus said, "It is finished," he took the sins of all the earth and he brought it onto himself. And then he died. The light went out, but he first was able to take all of the sin away from us, so that he nailed it to the cross with him. Now, next week and in the coming weeks, we're going to learn that that's not the end of the story, and Jesus will come back and be the light of the world yet one more time. But I want you to remember this week how Jesus, when he said, "It is finished," he took all the sins and he nailed them to the cross with him. Think about that. Have a great week. Talk to you soon.
You know, if there's one thing I've learned about racing and running, just on my own, that a racer is never done until he has crossed the finish line. Win or lose, he's got to finish. Well, there's a man from a small African country who had a dream to represent his country in the Olympics in Atlanta. He trained really hard to prove his worthiness, and again, he's going to run what is now the marathon, 26.2 miles in a race. And all of the wonderful activities were enjoyed as they got there, and finally the race day came, and along with hundreds of other racers from other countries, this gentleman lined up and was ready to run. They began on this hot pavement, and the runners ran step after step. 1 hour into the race, there were some racers who had already gone halfway through the 26.2 miles. Well, this African man was behind the pack for sure. Not just a little ways back. In 2 hours plus a few minutes, the winner crossed the finish line. Well, as time got later, this man still continued to keep running. And the crowds had long gone. He continued to keep running almost as if he thought he had a chance to win. And finally, minutes before the time limit, he crossed the finish line, hands raised. And again, just so we're clear, that would be 6 hours later. Some of the reporters came up to him and asked him why he didn't quit. And he replied with this. He said, "I am the first athlete from my country. And when I ran for them, not just for myself. And when they sent me here, they sent me not to only start the race, but to finish it." And we're all great starters, aren't we? I mean, we think of all the projects that we've started that still sit unfinished, that we say, one day I'm going to get that done. We have to finish what we started out to do. And just so we're clear today, Jesus actually does this. And we're going to read about it in John chapter 19, where we read again the sixth of Jesus' famous last words. In John chapter 19, verse 28, we'll begin. "Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that all scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, 'I am thirsty.' A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of a hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. And when he had received the drink, Jesus said his sixth famous last word, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. You know, there's a swinging paradox that absolutely takes place in the moments of Jesus saying, "It is finished." And it swings back and forth. It plows through this finished moment that Jesus is referring to on the cross. The paradox in many pages of God's Word are given in lots of different forms and different ways, but one such place is in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. It says this, it says, "In bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered." And I just ask this question, fitting? How is it fitting for God to send his only perfect son to die for us? How is this fitting? Well, just a few of the swinging paradoxes that happen in the moment of finishing on the cross. Here's just a few of them as I've heard them throughout the years. One of them is Jesus paid a great crime, and he paid for it with great love. There's a vast incongruity, and on the other side, a loving congruity. There's a perfect, holy God taking on a sinful people's sin. There's the world's worst and heaven's best. Jesus lifted high so that we might be lifted high. Life from death, hope from despair, grace for our crime. So much is finished here on the cross. You know, finishing isn't easy, but it's necessary. And finishing is one of the hardest things for man to do. We're such great starters, quick to embark on things that need to be done, but lacking the strength to carry it through. Max Lucado said it this way. He said, "Our human tendency is to quit too soon. Our human tendency is to stop before we get to the finish line. We start things and we don't always follow through, you know, like a partially mowed lawn, a half-read book, a letter begun but never completed, an abandoned diet, a car upon blocks, a cold faith, a job hopper, a wrecked marriage, and even an unevangelized world. We tend to lose focus and we're tempted to quit. We allow obstacles to hinder our success, or we begin to find blame and we blame others for the lack of help that they've been giving us along the way. You got to finish with strength and fervor and excitement and energy and passion that you started with. But this never really happened with Jesus. He stayed true until the very end what he was supposed to do. When he felt like quitting, he leaned in and he pressed into to relief and fulfillment and victory. Listen to what the writer of Hebrews chapter 12 says in Hebrews 12. Verses 1 through 3. I love this text because it reminds us again of how we don't want to stop running. "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." That does not sound like quitting to me. That sounds like leaning in to finishing. You know, the three words, "it is finished," that we write in English, that we read in this text, is actually found in one Greek word that I want to share with you. And the Greek word is tetelestai. Tetelestai is a word that to the servant would be this. When the job was completed, the servant would say to the master, "Tetelestai," meaning "I've completed the job that you gave me to do. I did it, I won, I overcame." And the master would say to the servant, "Well done." Well, to the priest, the Jewish people would bring their sacrifice to be offered. And after the high priest would examine it and accept it, he would say, "Tetelestai," meaning it's perfect, it's accepted. Now to the merchant, the debt would be fully paid. When you purchase something, the merchant would take the money and hand you a receipt, and on the receipt it would have stamped on it, "Tetelestai," paid in full. To the artist, When an artist would complete his work, he would step back and he would say, "Tetelestai, it is finished. The picture's completed, excellent work." When Jesus came, he completed the Old Testament picture of Christ, the Christ to come. He completed the picture and he turned the light on it and said, "It's finished." Not, you know, when we say the word, "it is finished," it's not a cry of defeat. I think sometimes we may have watched this thing, maybe on Mel Gibson's version of The Passion for the Christ, and we hear Jesus say, "It is finished," and we find ourselves weeping, going, "No." But it's not a cry of defeat, folks. It's a shout of victory. I think many times we read the famous last words, "finished," and we hang our heads because somehow we misunderstand what Jesus is saying. Jesus is not, this is not a word of shame or a word of defeat, but a shout of victory. Jesus has taken our sin and he has set people free from it. And Paul makes it even more clear what Jesus did in this moment when he says these words in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, great words that we share sometimes at a funeral, verses 55 through 57. "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." "It is finished" means death is beaten by Jesus, that his life handed over so that we would have life. And Jesus makes you a winner at this very moment. So in this word "finished," Jesus says, "It is finished." Well, the "finished" part, the "it" part, I want to talk about for just a couple of minutes here on all of what "it" represents. What is "it" that he finished? Well, first off, part of the "it" is the atonement for sin. Warren Wiersbe writes it this way: "None of the Old Testament sacrifices could take away sins. Their blood only covered sin. But the Lamb of God shed blood, and that blood can take away sins of the world." Now, Proverbs chapter 28, verse 13, kind of reminds us of how we're supposed to deal with our sin. It says, "Whoever conceals their sins does not prosper, but the one who confesses and renounces them finds mercy." You see, atonement for sin doesn't conceal our sin. It renounces its mercy. It brings, it allows mercy to be seen and for a relationship to happen. Hebrews chapter 9 says it this way in verses 24 through 28. "For Christ did not enter a man-made sanctuary that was only a copy of the true one. He entered heaven itself, now to appear for us in God's presence. Nor did he enter heaven to offer himself again and again, the way the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood that is not his own. Then Christ would have had to suffer many times since the creation of the world, but now he is prepared once for all at the end of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. Just as man is destined to die once and after that to face the judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people, and will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him." You see, Jesus finished his work on the cross all at one time. And the one time was for everyone and just once. Atonement for all at one time in one moment. 1 John chapter 1, verse 7 says it this way: "But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us," or cleanses us, "from all sin." Now, the word "cleanse" in this text actually means to declare pure, to make clean, to declare clean. You and I get washed up and declared clean by Jesus in the "it" part of "it is finished." Well, it draws us to a moment of communion to talk about the atonement of our sin. And Jesus is actually atoning for our sin. And we're reminded of that experience in Luke chapter, of the one we're getting ready to participate in, Luke chapter 22. Luke 22 verses 14 and following say it this way: "And when the hour had come, up in the upper room, Jesus had reclined at the table, and he said to them, 'I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God.' After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, 'Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink it again in the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.' He took the bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, given to you. do this in remembrance of me. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for the atonement of sin that you gave as you were reminding your disciples in the upper room of that moment when your life would be given for ours. And so now we come remembering again that sacrifice, again that you did in the upper room, that you've called us to do, reminding us again that it is finished. Thank you for finishing the work that you came here to do now. In Jesus' name, amen. We take this bread now and we eat it remembering again the body of our Savior. And again, taking the cup, we remember his blood that was shed on our behalf to give us life everlasting. You know, during the moment that we find this it, we not only find atonement for sin, but we also find that Jesus conquered death. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9 says it this way, "But we do not see Jesus, who was made lower than the angels for a little while, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone." You see, the angels, they can't die, but Jesus can. This verse lets us know that Jesus moved below the angels in this finished moment on the cross. Jesus took on death to reconcile us from death. To reconcile means to return favor with or to receive one with favor. Jesus took death so you wouldn't have to. Here's a third thing of what the it is, and it is finished. It's access to the Holy of Holies. Now, in the Old Testament, we had the Holy of Holies, the place that only the high priest could go into. It was a room divided by a curtain, and the priest would go into this place once a year. It was called the Day of Atonement, and he would go into this place to go and speak to God on behalf of the entire nation's sins. We read about it in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19 through 22. It says, "Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter, the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way open to us through the curtain, that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds." We find ourselves in the middle of the Holy of Holies now. Jesus now, through the work on the cross, finishes this portion, and he makes it possible for all of us to enter into a place where any one of us at any time can go before God with our request. Here's a fourth thing that it is on the it is finished. It's an acceptance by God. God accepts all of us. He calls us his sons and daughters. And again, we read about that in Ephesians chapter 1. Paul writes to the church in Ephesus in chapter 1, verses 3 through 6, and talks about this acceptance that we have because of what Christ Jesus has done on the cross. "Praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in heaven with realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose in us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with the pleasure and will." You see, Christ Jesus understands that at this moment that it is finished, we find now acceptance with God when we didn't have it before. We're now sons and daughters. We're a huge piece of understanding why God accepts us. Francesca Batticelli says it in this song called Royalty, which is just a beautiful, beautiful song about this acceptance piece. Listen to the words of this song. It says, "From rejected to accepted, from forgotten to remembered, from victim to the victor. Who we are is not the same, and it changes night and day. No longer orphans, now sons and daughters, worthy and wanted, we belong. From abandoned to exalted, from so broken to beloved, from the shadows to the light, from the dead brought back to life. And it changes night and day. No longer orphans, now sons and daughters, worthy and wanted, we belong." And then the chorus goes like this. We are crowned in dignity. We are heirs to his majesty. We're made for victory. We're given authority to reign like kings and queens. We are royalty. And that's a beautiful piece of this acceptance. And then this last piece of what Jesus is doing in finishing it is that he has we find confidence in salvation. I love this text in Isaiah chapter 12, verse 2. Isaiah says it this way: this is the confidence that comes from knowing Christ Jesus and knowing that it is finished. Surely, he says, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. The Lord himself is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. Hebrews chapter 10, again, we've spent a lot of time in the book of Hebrews today. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 12 says, "For by one sacrifice he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy." I don't know about you, but all of this is confidence in knowing that it is finished. Now, there are some reasons why Jesus had to finish all of this work for sure, and I have three of them that I want to share with you this morning. The first reason that Jesus finished what he came to do was he was highly motivated. I mean, and how was he highly motivated? He was motivated really by his amazing, unconditional love for you. In Psalm chapter 145, verse 8, it says this: "The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger," and I love this part, "rich in love." See, Jesus was highly motivated. His love for everyone was his motivation. He lived motivated, certainly makes a difference. It changes how we live. There was a fable about a dog that loved to chase animals, and he bragged about his great running skills and said he could catch anything. Well, it wasn't long until his boastful claims were put to the test by a certain rabbit. With ease, this little creature outran his barking pursuer. The other animals, watching with glee, began to laugh, and the dog excused himself by saying this. He said, "You forget, I was only running for fun, but the rabbit was running for his life." You see, Jesus he wasn't running for fun. He wasn't running for his life, but for yours. His love was for you at his heart. And when Jesus says finished, it was in this moment he literally ran his heart out for you. John chapter 3, verse 16 really is clear. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life." It was his love that motivated him. Here's the second reason that Jesus finished. It was because he was on a mission. Without question, Luke chapter 19, verse 10 is absolutely Jesus' mission. This is what Jesus says about himself: "For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." See, Jesus' life mattered in the grand scheme of things. His mission had to be lived out. And finding and saving lost people who are far away from God, that's his mission. It had to be lived out, and it had to be lived out to the very end. Jesus knew what needed to be done, and he understood how it needed to be accomplished. And here's the thing, he lived with no regrets. Living with no regrets is hard for many of us, isn't it? We've all experienced regret over the past. It takes a lot of different forms. Regret over relationships, regret over a divorce or a broken relationship, regret over a bad career move or missed opportunity or poor vocational choice. Regret is not following God's call. In general, regret all over all kinds of sins and consequences. Regret is unhealthy when it leads to an attitude of hopelessness. What difference does it make? We begin to say, "I've already messed up. I've already destroyed God's plan for my life. No matter how hard I work, I can never have anything more than second best. So why even try?" You see, the result of that attitude can just give in to ourselves and include the fact that we have sin. We have no attempt to obey God. But Jesus never lived with regrets because he understood his mission. And we have to understand our mission and reasons for being as well. Jesus taught us to live with purpose, finishing the task that he called us to do. And then this third thing that I see as a reason why Jesus finished the task that he did is because he knows his priorities. You see, after Peter rightly identified Jesus as Jesus in the Gospels, Mark chapter 8, verse 31 says this: what happened right after he identifies Jesus as the Christ? He says, "He," Jesus, "began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. That was his priority. He had direction. He had a compass, and it was the cross. Jesus knew what his priorities were, and he was here to accomplish them. There was a floor covering business where there was a sign in the window that said this, "Finishers wanted." Obviously, they were advertising for employees who would finish hardwood floors. But in God's kingdom, the finishers wanted sign is always out. The one who endures to the end will be saved. Is there any resolve in you to stay the course, to finish the race? Are you a finisher or a quitter? Are you a if you're a finisher, remember this. You are his witnesses. You're called to give testimony to that which you know to be true. We are to testify that Jesus is worth following. Learn that Jesus knew his priorities, and he kept them, and he finished them. So do you know your priorities in the kingdom? And if you do, would you finish them? So I just want to kind of sum up all of this finished moment with this statement. God is far more interested in your future than he is in your past. He's more interested in your finish than your start. After all, that's where we're going to spend the rest of our time, is with him. And our time here is so short. And Jesus knows that eternity is forever. And so Jesus finishes so that we'll be able to finish and end well and be in a better place. Read with how we're supposed to live this out in Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14. Philippians 3, 12 through 14. "Not that I have already obtained all of this and have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." Here's the thing. In Christ, there's no equal, not among men. Conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of a virgin, an earthly mother, a heavenly father, among friends, a friend that sticks closer to a brother, Jesus gave his all. He left the beauty of heaven and came to earth. He wore a crown of thorns so that you could wear a crown of life. He walked up Calvary's road so that you could walk on streets of gold. He was crucified on a cross and died that you might live. He was treated unjustly so you could be justified. He went to hell so you could go to heaven. No comparison, folks. When you see great men of the Bible, you see strength and you see weakness. But when you see Jesus, you see nothing but strength. No weakness in Jesus. "I find no fault in him," it was said of him. We all have a good side and a bad side, but Jesus, he's all good. No matter how you look at him, before Calvary, during Calvary, after Calvary, he is altogether lovely. And as you look at Jesus, there's a life that can never be copied, a righteousness that can never be tarnished, a peace that cannot be taken away, a rest that cannot be disturbed, a joy that cannot be diminished, a hope that cannot be disappointed, a glory that cannot be clouded, light that cannot be darkened, happiness that cannot be stolen, purity that cannot be defiled, wisdom that cannot be baffled, beauty that cannot be marred, a resource that cannot be exhausted. There's no need he can't meet, no hurt that he can't heal. Yes, it is finished. It means the servant had finished his work. The perfect sacrifice had been offered. Sin's debt had been paid in full. The picture had been completed. Jesus finished what he came to earth to do. Satan had been defeated. It is finished. Tetelestai. In closing, let me just say it this way. You just need to be able to say, "It is finished." I know Jesus said it is finished, but I'm calling you to say it is finished, to say it's over, to just say, "I'm glad it's finished. I'm stronger. I'm wiser. I'm better. I'm so much better." And don't live defeated. Live in victory because Jesus says it is finished. Whatever baggage you had, leave it here. It's finished. Whatever hang-ups you dealt with, leave it here. It's finished. Whatever disappointments slowed you down, it is finished. Whatever cross words and hurts slowed your progress, it is finished. Maybe you feel like you lost a year. Would you stop dwelling on it? Because it is finished. Still hurt by how they talked about you, it is finished. Mistakes you've made and will make, deal with them because it is finished. Friends walk away from you. It is finished. Relationships ended poorly. It's finished. Marriages have struggled. It is finished. Still carrying a mess. It is finished. Dwelling on aches and pains. Just know that you'll live and you'll not die. It is finished. No more tears, no more complaints, no more sleepless nights, no more attitudes of hopelessness. It is finished. Are you in need to forgive? It is finished. Are you in need of forgiving? It is finished. Just say it. It is finished. You see, with Jesus, you have a finished moment that's been taken care of for you. And now you and I get to live with the idea that whatever it is we stand in front, whatever stands in front of us, we'll be able to finish it because He was able to finish His good work in us. And I want to challenge you to do that, church, as we move forward in the coming days. Let me pray. Lord God, thank you again for the chance to be able to lift up one more song to you, to be able to again call ourselves to the cross, to be able to say our lives need to be finished of some of the things we've allowed our mind to dwell on. Thank you again for taking it on the cross and for allowing us to switch places so that you would give us life when we deserve death. You are such a good God. We love you now, serve you, and praise you. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in when death was arrested. Was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, with you. darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with the freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so
So as we come to this last piece of part of Jesus' famous last words, "It is finished," would you know, would you understand, would you walk into this piece of whatever it is that you have to face, knowing that when Jesus is with you on your side, that you can finish too? I think so many times we live kind of defeated before we can ever get started. And we kind of set the project aside and say, "It just can't be done." And it's not true. Jesus was able to see what it is he needed to do, fell into it, and absorbed it completely. And the reality is that when he says it's finished, he gives us victory, not defeat. Oh, how I want you to live that victorious way every day of your life, wherever you go and whatever you do. It's why we say so many times around here, now is when you're truly going to worship, because it's where you are going to put into practice the things that you already know that you've heard to be true. And I would challenge you to live a life of saying, knowing that Jesus has finished his good work, that you can finish yours as well. Let me pray about that as we journey forward. Now, God, be with us in all that we do and say, that we could truly live our lives in such a way that would find confidence and assurance in who you are, that we would walk with our heads high, knowing what it is you've done for us. That incredible love that you have for us, that you gave sacrificially for every one of us, brings us life. And it's not just life to come, but life for right now, in right now's problems and in right now's situations. We thank you again for finishing all of it so that we can stand confident with you. Help us to do that in the coming days again as we go and move in and about and live out our worship wherever we go. We thank you again for the body of Christ being able to gather this way. Be with them now as we're separate from one another. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you, church.